What's up and welcome to the stream and the YouTube video for people that are watching on YouTube. What's up, people? Today I'm working on overhauling the menu. Man, this has needed an overhaul for a long, long time. It was always kind of confusing that you would have your six buttons or whatever, your four buttons on the screen here at the bottom. And you go into this menu, and it used to have your buttons on top here too, and you couldn't really tell the fact that you could remap your buttons, so I'm going to make it a lot clearer by adding buttons on right here. What's up, Teak and Pedro and Arcane? What's up, y'alls? Welcome, welcome. How y'all doing today? Hey, guys. Hey, guys. Yeah, nice, nice, nice. So yeah, I'm just working out the code, so this will look a lot better once I get these buttons on here. Excuse me. Okay. Yeah, I know, right? He's being generous a whole minute. All right, so right now it's creating an input icon every single time. I need to create a little array of buttons so we can save these buttons and push them in the right place each time. You spent the day at a game studio testing your thesis with their developers. Might land a job there, fingers crossed. Oh, Pedro, I got my fingers crossed for you, man. I hope so, that sounds great. And it's over. They even took you to sushi? Whoa, nice. Best studio ever. Awesome, Pedro. I'm so excited for you. And how's your thesis going, man? Are you finished with it completely or what? Where are you at with that? All right, here's where I'm gonna do this function. Oh, here it kills everything. I don't necessarily need to. Buttons, we'll set these null pointer. Ah, here's the point where, no. Wait. Oh, yeah, that's where it removes it. Ah, here we go. Here's where it creates it. All right. Okay, here we go. We're looping over all the mappings, creating mapping sprites, and when it creates mapping sprites, I want to create button sprites as well. So it's all ready to go. I can show buttons next to each one of these equipables, which isn't actually a word. Equipable is not actually a word. I found that out recently. Equipable is, but it certainly seems to make a lot of sense for game developers. It's actually, I found a post on like English.stackexchange.com or something like that. They're like, can I use the word equipable? Basically, it's not actually a word, but most game developers do it. You gotta finish writing the document by tomorrow. Whoa! So your supervisor can read it, propose some changes. Uh-huh. You have to deliver by the 13th. Nice, dude. I'm excited for you. Yes, equipable is not a word, right? My whole game are all mini gamers. I just popped the bubble right there. I'm sorry. It's Friday the 13th. Crazy. What's today? Today's the 5th. All right, so buttons I. Oh, I'm using a method I don't really need to use here anymore. I don't need both these. Buttons I. Take the kit. Make a kit sprite for these. Yeah, actually this works. Setting the position to the same as the mapping's position. All right, yeah. See you, Pedro. Good luck, man. Rooting for you, dude. Have a good one. Can't wait to hear how it goes. All right, so why doesn't it like that? Oh. Oh. Hey Wiz, what exactly are you redoing on the equipment menu? Oh, let me show you. So the old equipment menu, oh, did I break it? This actually might be broken. Maybe it's, I don't know, I might have broken it, I'm not sure. Yeah, so before there used to be all your equipment on top. So your equipment shows up here on the bottom of the screen here with the HUD, right? Same with your courage, your diamonds, your little mini map. But when you go into this menu, it used to keep those on top. But the whole point of keeping those on top was to show you your equipment mappings, right? Like that your A button is mapped to the sword, the B button is mapped to the lighter and all that. But it never really was that intuitive. So what I'm trying to do now, or what I'm doing right now, is I'm making it so it's gonna show the button right here on this menu right here. So in your equipment menu, it's gonna have buttons next to everything. So it's very, very clear and intuitive how you remap things. You basically just hold the button down, press the button, and this should make it a lot clearer that that's what that is, you know, that this red background here is basically a mapping. So once I get these button icons on here, it'll look a lot better. And once again, I always develop things like this as sort of experiments, like I'm trying this out, and you know, if it doesn't work, I can always just go back to the old version. But like I said, the whole point is to make it more intuitive, to show you how to remap characters, and it's mostly for newer players that are just getting used to the game now. You know, people that have already played it, you already understand how to remap buttons usually. So it's more for new players to make it a little more intuitive. Oh, and by the way, Songbringer is on sale this week on Humble Bundle. If anybody wants to pre-order the game, you want to get it at a discount, this is the time to do it. Go look on Humble Bundle for Songbringer. Okay, I think I created the button just fine. Now I gotta set it. Oh, and this also sets the position for it. Okay. That's mapping's top. We're not even gonna need mapping's top anymore. Okay, actually, this is what this code should look like. Something like this. Set its opacity to zero. I always kind of struggle with mapping the buttons in Songbringer. Totally, man. It didn't work. It was a bad system before. Usually, you have A for select, B for back, and when I open the inventory, I wanted to go back, I press B, but that remapped the item. Oh. Yeah, it's a humble bundle. Yeah, it's definitely a steal. It's definitely a super duper steal at that price too. I accidentally set the price too low. I didn't mean to set it so low. It's like it's only like $5 right now, and the lowest I've ever sold it at is $8 for like for people in certain sales. So I didn't mean to set it so low, but just, oops, I can't change it now. But yeah, it's a limited time sale. It's like only this weekend or whatever. And yeah, maybe I should make something too where you have to hold the button down for a second longer or something like that to remap. I'm not sure exactly how to make it. Or maybe you press A to remap and then you just, it says like hold the button down to remap. Yeah, there might be a way more intuitive way to actually map the button. I think this is more of a better visual style to start with, you know, to visually show that things can be remapped. And then I'll work on the actual mechanics of it, like you're saying, the A select, B back. There might be a better way to do that to make it just more, you know, easier to use, more intuitive in how it actually works too. So if I buy it now a second time, do I get beta access? Technically, yes, I guess so. If you really want to do that, go ahead. I will honor that. If you want to buy a second copy in the current sale, and you already own a copy, sure. You can upgrade to beta that way. Yes, people do have expectations from controls and stuff like this is universally accepted. Yeah, and that would probably arcane. That would probably make more sense for the iOS version too. So, so that when you're in that menu on iOS, you would tap a certain button, and then, you know, something would pop up saying like, "Hey, hold down a button to remap," and then, or hold down a finger, however the heck it's gonna work on iOS. Your gambling luck, I know. All right, we need an offset. Button offset. Yeah, button offset's gonna be like -5, maybe 10, something like this. Set position of the same thing like that, plus button offset. And then we're doing the fade in and flash, same thing. Fade in, flash the button as well. I I can imagine selecting the item and then either holding it or a new window could appear and you could assign it. Or you could assign it not by pressing the button, but by manually putting the item in a correct slot. Oh. Huh. I guess you could just put it in its own slot. But I don't know. The thing about putting it in its own slot is that you don't actually perform that action as a player. So you're not, it's not as, it w I don't think it would be as intuitive as you actually having to press the button that you want, in order to confirm that you're, that's what you want. So if you're actually dragging it, like if you're dragging your button from something to the A button or whatever, you wouldn't actually be using that A button, so you wouldn't be mentally or physically associated, you know what I mean? Muscle memory. It's your muscle memory. You're using your muscles to press the button, the A, the B, the X, the Y, or whatever. That helps you associate it, I think, in your mind. So I think it would make it a little more intuitive to keep them somehow pressing the button or holding a button, or the button that they're meant to use, or whatever they want to use, I mean. Button, so getting these, this is where it's removing the current equipment. Here's where, oh, we want to set this input icon just right to. Yeah, holding the button. Input type. Equip index 0. And then I think I need to do this one other place. No, don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it yet. Don't lose again. Save it for 4,000 points, man. Save it. Don't think I can see you lose again, man. It'll crush me. I'll be crushed. You've probably been crushed the whole every single one of the times, but man, I can't take it anymore. I'm joking. You can do whatever you want, but okay. Input icon button, input type button. Oh, and this only needs to be done for the ones that are actually mapped. Okay, there we go. You're just gonna go to 399.99, so just to prove it. It's still not showing the buttons. What's up with the buttons? Something up either. Maybe I might have like changed the Z position of this button. Oh, I need Z plus what's this, the mapping one? Yeah, Z plus 4, just above the mapping. Yeah, that ought to be right. Hotline Miami for $5 too? Wow. What's up, Regathian? Lighter Thief, what's up? It's going good, man. It's going really good. All right, cool. We got buttons this time, but they're in the wrong position. They don't got their letters on them, but hey, that's a start. And they go away when you. I remap it, but all right, so let's get them easy to be in the right position to start with. I know, God protect my wallet. Must be sales season. Well, you know what it is? E3's coming up. People are like running their pre-orders and stuff. But it's probably the best to do a pre-order right after E3. I don't know. Humble Bundle knows what they're doing. They're the ones that planned the sale out. Yeah, the pretty one? Yeah, the name is like, what is it? Humble Bundle Eye Candy. That was it. Eye Candy. All right, so the button offset is like 0, not 10. And yep. Yeah, so what was that? What was the games in it they had in the Humble Bundle Eye Candy? It was like that Shantae video game. Which looks like it has some sweet pixel art. A sort of lighter thief would probably appreciate that art from that. I was playing Human Resource Machine. God, how much I hated assembly languages. Alright, so these buttons need to be further over. What was it? Shantae. Oh yeah, Human Resource Machine. So what is this Human Resource Machine one? Oh, it's a simple... What? Really? Cool. I like it. I like how they made it... They made a simple, like, programming game almost, but, like, made it look fun. This looks great. I like the art. Thank God programming isn't that annoying normally. But it teaches you in assembly, really? So I got to get the buttons here to show the right key, and I need them to look right for the on the controller. Yeah, Shantae, that's what I was saying. Shantae was kind of like your style of art, man. You probably appreciate what they're doing artistically. That's a little bit better. But still a little bit squashed. I want to make it spread out a bit more. Like maybe negative 12 here. And then when it's creating the items... Where does it put these? Hey, what's up, the gaming artist? I know how she attacks her ponytails. It's cool, right? I think she's kind of sexy myself. It's called assembly code, right? No, that's I don't think you're talking about assembly. No. Oh, wait, simple jumps. Jump of 0, jump of negative, add sub, moving between registers. Oh, yes, that's assembly. Yeah. Yep. Assembly's like move int, you know, 2 to a register AX. And then do something with AX. And then jump to somewhere else if AX is... greater than 3. Where the hell did I put this? Oh, it's in create sprites, not mappings. Here we go. This indent. Let's make this indent a little more. You're gonna take assembly next year? Cool. You hate assembly code? Yeah. Well, you do in 100 lines of code, you could do in like 1 or 2 in normal languages like C. Yes, you're right. You're totally right. The one thing about assembly, though, is that you can write really fast code because you can get way down to the level of machine. You basically get closer to machine language than you can with C. But C, I mean, C is pretty dang close to machine language anyways. You're getting pretty efficient code with C. So like if I remap that, I need to see that last one as a button. I'm thinking this is a... maybe a few more pixels. I like the way these are right now. I guess maybe just a few less pixels this way. You love working as close as possible as machine level? Wow, cool. I'd love to do a project at some point where the character has just one outfit and you can fully focus on all kinds of animations. Yeah. Uh-huh, yeah, you gotta focus on a lot of different cosmetics. I know, totally. Yeah. Yeah, that's why this guy here in Songbringer, he's got one outfit. He's just got his shirt off. It's because I'm lazy. I can't do all the work of so many goddamn animations. You know, there's already so many goddamn animations because you can take your hat off. You can have the sword equipped. You can have no sword. You can have the sword on your back. It creates just a lot of work for that one character. Now that's pretty good. This is starting to feel right. It's from a feng shui perspective. Now let's get the buttons to actually show the right letter. Yes, yes. We understand each other. Human resource machine is a bit too easy though. Oh. Oh really? You can just do loop unrolling and you get top grades? I don't know if that's the right message to send to people. You know, loop unrolling is great for solving some situation, you know, for optimizing, but is it really the best way to keep your code? Is it the most readable? I don't think that's a very strong good message to be sending people that are learning especially something like assembly. Loop unrolling is when you have, you know what a loop is, right? When you loop over something like this right here. I'm looping over for int I equals 0. I is less than the number of item types. So basically this is a for loop that goes from I 0 to 1 minus, or this number minus 1. And to unroll a loop, you would just not do this for loop. You would actually just do all this code here 6 times or whatever that is, you know? And that increases the performance of your code because A, you're not having to jump at the end of this, at the end of this you would jump back to this point, and also you would compare I to see if it's less than that certain number. So there's a lot of inefficiency going on there before you unrolled your loop. When you unroll the loop, you're taking out those two instructions and you're making the overall code run a lot faster. But the problem is, it's not very future-proof, and it's not very readable. Oh, and another benefit to loop unrolling, though, is that you're especially when you're writing shaders, loop unrolling is very powerful because especially with shaders, you're executing multiple different parts of your code at once, right? Because processors have, you know, multiple cores, the multiple cores can process things at once, right? And if the second you put an if in your code, technically a for loop is an if every single time you go through a single iteration of your loop, you're calling if. Is I still less than num item types? It has to do that each time, right? So the thing is, when you're writing shaders, it's way faster to unroll your loops because you can execute code in parallel a lot faster because it's called a branch weight, or what are they called? Somebody knows, I'm sure, here on the stream. You guys can tell me what I'm trying to say or whatever. But anyways, I hope you get the point I was trying to say there. Shader code faster if your loops are unrolled. Basically, shader code in general is faster if you have no if statements whatsoever or loops. And that's in general. Some of the modern day GPUs are a lot better about how they handle branching, which is if statements, basically. and they're a lot smarter. So I don't know how applicable that is. I guess it's still pretty damn applicable because people still do it a lot. You know, programmers are always optimizing their shaders. Okay, so what is it about these buttons that it's not showing? It's not showing the letter of the button or whatever. Well, I'll just dive in here. Set a breakpoint there, figure out what input type it's sending here. But they hint at you not being able to get both in the same run for everything. Mm. Okay, so we've created the sprite. We put it in the right place. I like the way it's placed visually. Looks good. Current input type is keyboard. We're stepping into this input icon method where it's grabbing the string. Good. Oh yeah, it's got the letter K. I guess it's just this right here where it's doing. Oh, add input type label. This has got to be it. It's got the right sprite. That's for sure. It's got the right string. Still got the letter K. So yeah, it must be here when it's going add input type label. We got a parent. We're using the parent's global Z order plus one. We got the default camera flag though. Oh, and parent's opacity. Oh, it's the opacity. I usually get the grade for number of instructions, but the second one is harder for me. We don't know how it calculates the number of steps or how to minimize it. Hmm. Hmm. Huh. So what I've got, the problem I've got here in front of me is that there's three sprites I'm trying to fade in here. There's really one sprite I'm trying to fade in. It's the button. And the button has a child entity, which is the letter on the button. And that child is not getting faded in because it's not. It starts with its opacity and then it just never gets a fade action. So what do I do here? What do I do? I guess the simplest thing I could do is just to start it. Code obfuscation, yeah. I know, right? Yeah, fluid simulations in one or two lines of code, right? Hmm. Hello, Moth Teeth. What's up? Welcome. Every one of these children, I guess we'll just set their opacity to 255 for a moment. See if that fixed it. Yes, UI programming today. I'm just working on making this some more intuitive. Hey, there we go. Yeah, that was definitely the problem. It didn't have the opacity for these buttons. Okay, now the next thing I want to do is make it so this works. So if I want to remap this button here. It's going to put, it does look like it gets rid of the button. It just doesn't set it. Which is probably the same, something to do, probably similar with the opacity, you know. Here we go. All right. Oh, we need to set the button position as well. Buttons, equip index, set position sprite, get position plus, the button offset. That should do it. This will be almost looking right. And then, what next? And there's a few more things to get right here, like the number of items per row changes. So if there were one more item on here, it would be going past the end of the side. Yeah, there we go. Nice. We got buttons showing up right. Can remap things. It shows me my new button I'm using. Yes, this is what I wanted to see. Bleep, 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 bleep. Fade in part first. So I just want to make their. Yeah, I guess I'll have to do a separate loop for right here when it creates the input icon. We got count times 5, total plus 1 times 0.5. I think I'll wait till the end and just make them fade in at the end. Hey, what's up, Zanger? Welcome, welcome, welcome. How's it going, man? All right, so end run action. All we need to do is fade in. Yeah, so fade to, always better to use a fade to than a fade in. Fade to, oh, delay time. Delay time, sorry. So sequence. Delay time. And this 0.5 should be a constant. Delay per. Alright, Lighter Thief, see you, man. Yeah, I know, getting so close to 365 days. So close. So 5 days left. I'm going to do a drunk stream. I'm going to do a drunk playthrough. That's my goal. I think I can hit that goal, doing a drunk playthrough on day 365. I think I'll make it an issue, right? Like, or make it an event, you know? I'll like post on Twitter that I'm going to be drunk on stream. But I won't actually be that drunk. It'll just be that I'm drinking. I'll be drinking and playing the game. Playing Songbringer and celebrating the fact that I've been streaming. I actually have a year's worth of streams, 365 streams. Now, this is the game's been in development for about a year and a half now, but that's total an actual year, a whole year of streams. All of them over, most of them about 2 hours long. That's like 365, it's like almost 730 hours of live stream so far. Just don't let your drunk self touch the code. No worries, man. I got Git. I'm good. I can code all I want, all the craziest stuff in the world. And I can go back to last night's master if I want. Delay per. Delay per, and then use delay per everywhere else. So this is no longer a magic number here, this important number. Get good. 700 plus hours of live coding. That's nowhere near counting the whole project's amount of coding. But, you know, how many hours do I actually work on the game compared to streams? I don't know, I would guess 10 hours of development, or let's just say conservatively at least 8 hours. No, it's more like 10 because I don't stream on weekends, you know? Anyways, probably total hours put into this project, I'm just gonna totally guess. If it's 700 hours of live streams times 10, it's probably 7,000 hours I've put into this game so far. 7,000 hours, wow. Okay, anyways, total, let's capture total. Delay, fade to. Oh, capture delay per. Oh, what do you think of this laser emitter? Cool, man. I like it. Yeah, that's cool. Love it, man. Love it. Just don't let yourself rebase anything while drunk. Definitely not, Regathian. Actually, I tried rebasing once, and I totally messed up my repo. And it wasn't irreversible. Git is really flexible. You can totally fix just about anything. But yeah, I did rebase once and broke everything. I was like, oh no! I even posted a Stack Exchange question. I was like, oh, how do I fix this? And I wasn't even drunk then. I was completely sober, messing with Git in ways that I didn't really know what I was doing at the time. Yes, I did, Deke, I did. I just used calc 2 times 10. What's up, Thomas? What's up, man? How you been? There we go, but no, we're missing the letters now. Oh, there, they faded in at the end. Okay, that wasn't cool. Not at the end, man. Not at the end. It just needs a different delay time. Oh, we know this is not equal to the gear end. You know what? Oh. That doesn't have any gear. Yeah, it only needs to be here. And it only needs to be count times delay per. Now I guess we gotta capture count. Just can't go, can't multiply by 10. Can't do it. On math exams, I'd use a calc to do 1 plus 1. I just don't trust myself. Really? Wow. You're drunk now? Nice, man. Good seeing you, too. Yeah, Wolfram Alpha. 1 plus 1. That's all you need. Wolfram Alpha. Hey, that looked good that time. All right. This is looking great. Right? This is a lot more intuitive than it used to be. You can actually just see visually right. I'm editing exactly what I want to edit. Cool. So like, if I want to set up my lighter as G. Or, why does it say L? That's wrong. It's not L. Everything's wrong. It's not K. That's F. Okay, we gotta figure out the letters. Something's wrong with the letters. It is starting to look good, right? Yeah. Just the letters are wrong. Why are the letters wrong? Let's find out why. Is this supposed to be a button index or something, not an equip index. Ah, that's probably it. I probably did button index versus equip index. Button index is going to be like an actual button that you use, not the it's your binding, comes from your bindings. This one should be the sword. String. Oh, that's that. I needed to see that. Damn it. So just give me K for button index. 0, which is up. Oh, right. Yeah. Okay. So this is supposed to be button index. Button index. Where do I get that from? Is that somewhere in? I think I would need to grab the actual binding. Wait, mapping's top. No, mapping's top doesn't use it. I guess it's only in game scene. Where I do the same kind of thing here. Set input type. It applies to images. Oh, button index is button A plus I. Duh. Oh, that's so easy, right? Okay. Should be const. All right, input icon, button A plus I. That's just so funny to me. Easy stuff, man. Okay, button A plus equip index there. Okay, now we should have the right letters. And then I'll try it out with the controller. Make sure that works. Xbox controller. Bling. Yeah, S, F, yes, S, D. Oh, it's so refreshing to press buttons that I'm actually pressing and see what I'm actually pressing is. It's working. Yes, very cool. All right, well, let's say I want the blink orb to be V. Could be C. my settings the way they were. Let's I can just plug in my controller. This should just work. It's even better, it's even more intuitive with seeing these actual Xbox icons here. These are pretty cool. Alright, those look good. Yeah, I'm really, really liking this. Really liking this. For some reference here, let me show you guys the old menu. Let's take a screenshot of that. Did that screenshot get taken? Yeah, so there's an example of the new menu. Let's go look at the old menu real quick. Yeah, the buttons do look good on there, huh? It really helps to just clarify. You do love buttons, that's right. I forgot we had this conversation. Button love. Right? They have a nice shine to them. There's PlayStation buttons too, man. If I had a PlayStation controller, it would just show me PlayStation buttons. Actually, let's look at the PlayStation buttons. While it's connecting to my Steam account. PlayStation buttons. If I want to force all buttons are good buttons. There's somewhere where it sets the input type. Oh yeah, we'll just go into this set input type function. And we'll just set to always be K input type PlayStation. Interesting fetish. I think it's cool. Yeah, so there's what it would look like on a PlayStation controller. Yeah, these look good too. Still got the Xbox colors, but like, that's okay. It's more just to show you that it's mapped to something. All right, yeah, I'm really liking this. This is perfect. Don't push the red button. Yeah, so last thing it would be to make these items work well per row. I mean, the items per row needs to be fixed. I think this is a good enough place to check in, though. I'm going to check in right here. Oh, still connected to my Steam account? Oh, you know what? I don't need Steam open to play it from the Steam folder. Yes, it is so much better, right? Now just make it a long press? Yeah. Yeah. I think that's probably the simplest way to do it, right? Just to make it a long press. I think I would need to put some text up there too. It'd be like, hey, hold down the button for a minute to, maybe not. I don't know. Maybe I could just do a little like progress bar that appears the second you start pressing a button. A progress bar appears, and as soon as the progress bar gets to it's finished, then boom, it remaps. What was the one thing I got to do before I check this in? I don't know, nothing, I guess. Hold it for a whole minute. Why not? Yeah, this is good. Good. All his code's looking. Oh, I guess I should take that out. Yeah. You gotta earn it. Whole minute. See, totally, the progress bar is like barely getting bigger. So I had this supplementary method, complementary, supplementary, supplemental. I had this supplemental method there that was not needed. I'm getting rid of You never really want to add too much code if you don't need it. Every freaking function you write is something else that has to be compiled, put in headers, and that kind of stuff slows everything down. So, and secondly, it's code you have to maintain later. Someday this code might break. The less code you have, the better, really. Always. Less code equals better. Okay, yeah, good enough. I checked this once, I checked this twice. I'm making my list and I'm checking it twice. Yeah, totally, right? Good, yeah. We're all in agreement about this. Less code is better. In general, what I just did here was simpler, more intuitive equipment mapping. Okay, the last thing I need to fix is the items per row. Let's illustrate the problem here. If I have more things that I could equip, for example, I know you can equip a map and a compass. So let's get a map we can equip. Two maps. Let's get two maps we can equip. Bombs? Oh, bombs also. Bombs can be equipped. Let's get a bomb container. Do bomb container 10. These skills are not actual skills yet in the game, but they're equipable. So I'll put charge as an equipable thing for now. Bomb. Let's make sure the player has some bombs so that'll show up. Boots, glove, cactus. Oh, cactuses, same thing. We need to be able to equip cactuses. We got a cactus container. Got a cactus container. Okay, I think that's about all the things that we need to see equipped here. Our teacher at college teaches also little kids who could be in second grade or elementary school. Whoa. And they hate short code. They try to make it as long as possible. Because to them it looks more professional. Oh man, I know, right? So I hate it when people teach children to code before teaching them the basic of algorithms. Yes, binary, basic math, explaining them the beauty of programming math. Yes. You know what I wish when people were teaching programming, here's what I wish was taught: cohesion. I'm talking about this Wikipedia link here, cohesion computer science. It's basically not coupling your code. Coupling is such a bad thing. Coupling is when you go and you write something twice, basically. That's all it is. Coupling. You've coupled two systems in that they're totally dependent on each other, and you've written things kind of in the same kind of thing twice. So cohesion means that you write everything and you keep it in one place, and you're not making modules that depend on each other and stuff. Cohesion's awesome. I wish people would teach this basic concept. Whenever they teach programming, this concept I think should be one of the first things you teach. Cohesion. Cohesion and readability. That's also a huge thing. Readability. which is cohesive code is more readable, of course, but readability in general is, you know. Yeah, most enterprise apps have at least 5 times as much code as they need. This is true. It's true. It's like that one. That's one. That one comic or whatever about that. Here's what code looks like at a company. Here's what code looks like to a CS student. Yes, cohesion. Thomas. You... Yeah. Enjoy, man. Yeah, so here, the problem is now quite illustrated, right? We've got 4 buttons stretching out into this ether region. The nether region of the side of this. So we need to have 6 buttons only on the top, and in this bottom row here can have its normal 11 things. Alright, and I did all that to check in because I know this is going to be a little bit tricky at first because items per row is going to be different now for the passive items and versus the equipment items. You have a thing with generic code. In my mind, I want to know write programs with no if statements at all. Oh, code that will know how to handle every possible input. Oh, interesting. I like that. First time I've seen coding was at college. Yeah, I know, right? And you mean, yeah, like primary schools and stuff? Yeah. Is the first time you saw real coding was here? Really? So, yeah, items per row. We're going to need 2 items per row. Items per... passive row, items per equipment row. Really? Wow. Reducing conditionals where possible is a good starting point for minimizing code. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It makes things beautiful, too. I love it. Started coding in 6th grade? Whoa. Right. But isn't it crazy I remember that, too. I remember becoming cognitively, like, more capable. It was amazing. It was a really crazy time in life. And I, you know, to become like, whoa, I understand this stuff now. It was a cool moment in my life too. I'm glad we can share that same kind of experience. So equipment rows, we only have 6. Passive rows, we have 11. When we're placing it, we need to know we can just go items per row, const in items per row is passive. Items per passive row. Otherwise, items per equip row. Might need that here in a second. You don't think it should be in elementary schools? Yeah. I don't know. I think kids in elementary school can get it, but like. Not the higher concepts. Yeah, of course, not really the higher concepts. But I think some of the basics of programming kids can definitely pick up, you know, early on. They're not going to understand how an entire video game works, you know, and not how or any kind of complex piece of code. But sure, you know, the basics. Started coding in 7th grade. But it wasn't until working on a project in 10th grade where I suddenly realized how to put things together and make sure. Yeah, uh-huh. It took you a long time to understand arrays, really. Do you think people today think in zeros and ones? I think programmers do. Some programmers do. You started in 5th grade. Whoa. What's an int? Yeah, nice. Glad she taught you the basics well. You're training yourself to understand binary? Cool. I just found out today that the ancient Babylonians used a base of 60. Did you guys know that? They actually counted 0 to 60. That was their 10. Their 10th number was 60 or whatever. 10 represented 60, basically. Base 60. You guys know what bases are. What am I trying to explain bases for? Items per row. So we need to know what row they're on right now before we can add to the selection. Oh, well, this is not too hard either. Items per row is just if the current selection, no, selected is less than active gear dot size. That should allow the cursor to move better. And then I'm sure it's going to be something else here. Yeah, move selection. I know they had so many symbols, right? What's up, Space My Name? I know they are. They are. They're the ones for our times, not being neatly divisible. They actually counted when they would count like up to 60 or whatever, they would use the right hand or whatever one of their hands, like as the 10th, you know, or as your second digit, basically. So this would be, you know, 60, 120, 180 or whatever. And then they would actually count the 12 part on their knuckles. So it was like one, you know, 1, 2, 3 or 0, 1, 2. I'm not sure how they counted, but like, you know what I mean? That's how they would count to 60 using their knuckles or the lines in their fingers and like the other hand of fingers or whatever. Add equals items per row. And this is just -1. It's greater, less than -1. Simplify that. Add is greater than 1. Add is less than -1. They were, yeah. And I guess the reason they used base 60 because it could, they're too clever for their own good. The reason they used base 60 was that it divided so well, right? Because you can divide 60 by 12, you can divide 60 by 10. You can divide 60 by 6, 4, 3, 2, 1, 5, 8. Can you divide 60 by 8? No. Can you? No. You can't divide 60 by 8. No, not quite. Mm-hmm. Someone make a time machine and hit them in the head so we can have base 10 times and counters. Yes, please. Yeah, based on the rotation of the Earth, yeah. Yes, that's right, yeah. I was just watching this documentary this morning. The Story of Maths, Marcus du Sautoy. He's a professor from Cambridge. Okay, so add selection, move selection. Here's where we jump up to passive gear, which means that we want to mod our selection by items per passive row. And here we're jumping down to the active equipment, so we want to go items per equip row. And this also items per equip row. And that should be all of our all of the usage for items per. Oh wait, there's one more here. Let's hope this all works right. Anybody been to Hackathon? No, I haven't. What's Hackathon again? Is that the one where you're Oh, to a hackathon. Oh. Is that like a game jam? What is a hackathon? An event in which computer programmers and others involved collaborate intensively. Oh. So what's like one of the most recent hackathons? Oakland Hackathon. Check it out. There was one here right here in my hometown. This was last year. Cool. Yeah, that would be pretty neat to like work on something, you know, collaboratively with a lot of people, especially something that would like, you know, you're passionate about. I'm sure that would be really cool. Hey, look at that. We've got, it's looking kind of weird because of this charge. Let me get rid of that. That's throwing me for a loop because it's not an actual item or anything yet. You can earn cash too. Whoa. Sign me up. Can always use more cash. Puppu is kill. Yeah, he's around. Puppu's around. He's just he's sleeping today. He's taking vacation. All right. Yes. Good. So I'm using the left and right arrow keys here to move. And what I just checked here is that this edge works fine. And if I go from there to there, it's properly wrapping the amount of items based on the active item total. And then if I press right once here, yeah, that works too. If I press up though, up is not really working. It's not like lining it up with the right, But what about if I go down? Like, let's say I'm at this row here, which would be the third item. If I press down. Oh, I guess it is working at least down. That's technically what it should be. If I'm out here at this edge, it would be. No, it's not quite right. Yeah, Teak, that's what I'm working on. I'm working on making it so it's actually direct, right? I want this to be, you press down and it goes straight down, even if it's going to a different number of items per row. So it's just a trick of math here. Just gotta get this math correct. Talking to Babylonians. Okay, I'm gonna focus on this one here first. This one is like close to being right. It's just one too many. I think it's where we're moving. You followed Zero, but you unfortunately came to a screen where I couldn't enter his dungeon. Thomas, what world seed were you using? I will check this out right now, because I was working on a fix for that, and I thought I had fixed it permanently, like it would never have any problems getting to Zero. And also, I need to know your world seed, and I also need to know when you played. Please let me know what day you played on, because I want to make sure you were using the latest version, because there was a... It was Thomas, all right, Thomas. And what was your, what day did you play on? Let me go to your seed here. Let's check this out right now. 2 days ago? Okay, so that was, yeah, you would be playing, definitely playing the new version. Okay. Let's put me right here at negative Negative 12, so I can just walk out of the cave. Oh, it seems to have worked for me. Did yours look like this? It seems that I can walk here. Now I can get through these throwback tiles. Was there something else blocked off? Wait a minute, did I just walk on some water there? I did. You can walk onto water right there. That's definitely a bug. Yours look different? Oh no. You came from the right? You mean the left? Because I'm coming from the right. But anyways, I think yeah. Really? You're playing on Windows, right? Let me get to the version that was uploaded to Steam just to make sure it's like we're on the same page. I think I got a link to this. Steam app. Okay, so I'm playing the version that was uploaded to Steam this Sunday. And let me go to my saves and I'll change my save. So it's using Thomas. Concrete blocks your way. Okay. Oh, Thomas. Okay, one question though. Were you online? Were you able to update your version? Because if you weren't able to update your version, then you could have been playing an old version, and that's what really could have caused it. You do have updates automatically. Okay, so you're connected to the internet and it updated for you? I'm thinking you probably did. So let's see if this works here. I meant to take a screenshot of this anyways, so that's what the old menu looks like. Okay, if only I had God mode. Was it this way? Am I going the right way to it? Yeah, the zero was in the version from the earlier in the weekend as well, but throughout the weekend I fixed a lot of bugs. And one of them was fixing his entrance. Oh, I found level one. Oh, but it's pointing me up that way. Maybe it's this way. You did the left route. Oh, you're on the left. Okay, left. Left it is. Does this look like your world? Oh, is it straight to the left? Oh, there, yeah, I see two. It's right there. Okay. Yeah, this looks like the same screen to me as that I had just a second ago. Yeah. I'm thinking that you may have been playing the old version. I could confirm this. Let me think of how I could confirm this. I want to copy that. Oh, I know what I could do. I can go to my copy of it from, yeah, I think it's probably fixed, but let me just make sure. I don't want to... Well, yeah, I mean, it really all signs are pointing to the fact that it probably is. But let's see. 4:30 was the one I released before the weekend on Friday. So I can unpack this and play this one. Wait a minute. Did I do swords on this one? Oh, yeah. I want to do Thomas. And, yeah. Yeah, I'm thinking for some reason yours didn't update. You didn't quite get the update. Maybe you were offline or something when you played it that time, or maybe you just couldn't connect to the Steam server to update or sync or whatever, or maybe it was about to sync and it didn't finish. I don't know. Yeah, this is the same world too. Wait. Oh, yep, there, yeah. This is probably what yours look like, huh? You're all blocked by these pillars and stuff. Yeah, don't worry about Zero not showing up. But that's just because this save game is a little different. But yeah, I'm pretty sure your screen probably looked like this. And that's totally it. Okay, so it didn't update your version. So all you gotta do is just get on Steam, make sure you're connected to online, and it should update your version, and then this will be fixed for you. So yeah, it's already fixed in the latest Steam version. Okay, cool. Good to know that's not a bug anymore, or hopefully it isn't a bug. Yeah, cool. Okay, so back to making this these just jump their position the right way. We want to go jump down to active. No, we want to jump up to passive. There, I'm gonna set a breakpoint here and figure out what's wrong with the math where it's adding more than one or whatever. Okay, good. It did jump. It's running the code that I thought it was supposed to be running here. So jump up to passive gear. We've got an add of 6. Whoa, there's the problem. So we know add is greater than 1, which means it's using the items per row. And yeah, this just needs to be reset right here. So add becomes items per passive row. Maybe. This might be wrong too. Hey, what's up, Jonah? How's it going, man? I haven't seen you in a minute. I hope you've been good. Hey, guys. Oh, that's definitely wrong, too. Okay, so we got that jumps to completely the wrong position. So yeah, it is meant to be this, that's right. Selected plus add mod items per passive row. Yeah, cool, man. I hope things are going well for you. What's going on in life, man? What's up? Were you at school? Is that right? University? I guess I'm gonna just, yeah, I gotta see this math. Total active, total passive. These should be const. Yeah, exams. Ooh, exams next week. Yeah, I think a lot of people have been doing exams. I noticed a lot of people mention it on the stream, like just either finish their exams or got to go into their exams. Okay, we're pressing down. The add is 6 based on the rows that it was already in. The selected, what is this selected? 6, we're currently at 6. Yeah, it's 6, which would be the first index of the last row. So A becomes selected 6 plus add, which is 12. Mod items per passive row, which would be, this would all become 0. And then selected equals total active plus 0. Well, let's see if this comes out to actually be 0. No, it comes out to be 1. Why does it come out to be 1? Selected 6, add is 6, that's 12. 12 mod 6. Oh, this should be items per active row. We're already, or in the equip row. Oh, duh. I guess those are probably, these next ones here down here are probably flipped as well. So I'm here. Yeah, nice. If this should move me down to the third one. All right, cool. Let's make it a little smarter now. I want it to, when it's here at the third item in this row, it should step down to like the middle of the other row. So it should be based on the other row's Yeah, right. Thanks, Bapu. Hey, Bapu's here now. Total active plus A. Okay, I got it. So in A is now going to become the current selection mod the items per equip row. That's going to give you like a float of like a float percentage. Or no, if we do this floated. He does, he's listening. This divided by items per equip row floated. That's going to give you a percentage, and then multiply that by the items per passive row. And then L round F the whole thing. Yay, kapow! So if I'm here at the third item, yeah, nice! It puts me about at the right place. There, it's putting me almost straight down. If I'm here, straight down, yeah. What if I'm all the way over here? Straight down. Oh, nice. Put me in this. Cool. If I'm I'm about there. It moves me. All right, this is working well. Okay, now I just got to get it to so it jumps up a row correctly. And it's probably this that I need to flip all these items per row. Yes, you found a beer. Nice, nice. What are the items categories? There's two categories. There's your active equipment, which you can map to things and use by pressing buttons. And then the other type of equipment is your passive items, which always work all the time. Let's get open. I'll get open a screenshot so we can see what it used to look like and what it's now looking like. Here's what it used to look like. And here, let's make this 3,200 tall. Here's what it looks like now, sort of. This is today's goal, basically. I'm just working on making the gear menu look more pretty and be more intuitive, basically. So there we go. There's our old, this is the old menu. You see it has this basically unnecessary stuff on the top, and it's really did not make it clear that, you know, that this little yellow color means that you can remap to that button. So instead of that, I got rid of all this stuff and just made it so you can see actively, oh, look, I've got the A button equipped to that or the Y button there. And I'm gonna make it so your diamonds show up as a passive item right here. So you still got all the data that you would have had. It's just that it's cleaner and you can intuitively know what's mapped to what. What about the speaking bush? I noticed the active equipments are grouped into three. Yeah, they're grouped into six. That's just how much fits into one row. Okay, so jumping down to active equipment, I'm pretty sure this is just the mod is different. Yeah, thanks, Taiho. What's up, Taiho? How you doing, man? I think this is items per passive row. Int A. Selected minus total active mod total float total active over total mod total. Wait. Yeah. Yeah, I'm doing good too, man. Doing good. Doing what I love, man. I love to make video games, and this game is coming along really good. I'm really, really, really proud of what I've done with Songbringer. Yeah, thanks, man. It does look a lot more polished, but really it's playing a lot more polished too. You can feel the difference a real big difference, because the characters have a lot more dialogue now. So you, like for the littlest things, like finding your first diamond, for example, there's a little bit of dialogue that happens for that. So you get the sense that there's context going on, you know, there's these characters are interacting and they, you know. It's still not working right. Maybe that did need to be a quip index. Or maybe let me just think about this math here. It probably just needs to be as simple as that. This is like a one-liner. We're jumping down to the active equipment, so we need to take where we're at on the current line and make it where we're at on the next line below. And then if it's greater than a certain number, we put it at the line before. Yeah. So this is almost like this line here. We take the current selection, mod items per passive row. Immersion's important in games. Yes. I'm really looking forward to play when it's done. Yeah, cool, man. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to having it done, too. It's not too far away at this point. It's a lot more mature than it was even a few months ago. Really what's got to get finished now is the enemies, dungeons, items. Items first. I really got to get all the items finished because a lot of the items create new mechanics, and new mechanics create new features. That creates feature creep. So really the point is to get all the items finished right now so that there's a lot less feature creep going on in the last few months of this game's development. And then, yeah, it'll be mostly enemies, the story elements for the end of the game, the cutscenes, and boom, it should be done. Selected items for passive row. Divided by items for passive row. Times items per equip row. Okay, so we need a base. The base is going to be, yeah, floor, total active. I think it's just like this. It's weird programming in C90? Really? What's been different in the latest Cs? What's up, Elite SCB, by the way? Does the latest C, I've always been wondering, does the latest C have lambdas? This was 5 years ago. Wait, is there such a thing as C11? What are we at now? Is there a C14 or a C11? All right, we had C99. Oh, there's a C11. Adds numerous features. Type generic macros. I'm not sure what that means. Anonymous structures. Ain't cool. Improved Unicode support. Who cares? Atomic operations. What's that? That sounds good. Multi-threading. Don't need it. Bounce checked functions. What's that? Some portions of the existing C99 library optional. Improves compatibility with C++. Oh, you got alignment specification. Okay, good. Type generic expressions using the generic keyword. Oh, interesting. You can add, it automatically adds L's and everything to your macros. Wow, that's really crazy. Look at that. Is anybody else seeing this? This is crazy. C11 has that. Multi-threading support, Unicode. Removal of the getS function? What? Oh, there's a new safe version, getSS. More macros for querying the characteristics of floating point types. I don't really care about this stuff. I was hoping they would have lambdas, man. Static assertions. Wow, this is not as cool as I thought it would be. Anyways. This is items per equip row. Okay, so B is the floor of the total active. Which is your number of active things, which would be 9 in this case, over the items per equip row. Yeah, this becomes a percentage. All right. See you, Thomas. Later, dude. B. I'm not fully understanding this math yet, but I think I might have fixed it. Just gonna try. If it doesn't work, I'll step through the code and figure it out. So we can accurately move sections when you're pressing the up key. It should just go straight to the right at part of the next key or part of the next section. Down is working great. Up, almost. Hey, that was like, it should have moved me to this one. What if I'm over here? Almost. It's like, yeah, it's kind of almost right, actually. Because it's using floor F here. This should be L round F, not floor F. Yeah, B should become a percentage. That was a problem. From right here, I press up. It moved me to there. So that's, the math is wrong still. Yeah, something's definitely wrong here. Okay. So that kind of like ruined it. We'll figure out what's going on by stepping. The old workhorse of the programmer, the debugger. It's always nice to just step through and see what the code's actually doing rather than trying to think through exactly what could be going on, because you never quite know what happens in a system until you run it and you go, oh, this system's doing that. I'm here, I press up. It should move me straight up to the next one above. Okay, so we got selected this is apparent to me what's going wrong already. Selected needs to be minus total active here, and then mod that by items per passive row. Yeah, just that might have fixed it. Let's see. One of the next things on my list is going to be to make controller rumble, finally. We wanted to add rumble for a long time. This is going to be fun to finally have rumble. That'll be a nice, like, cherry on top type of... Yes, look at that. It went straight up. Straight up. Yeah. Oh, it's working. It works perfectly. Yay. Awesome. Yay! What's up, Elite? Oh, so I already said hi. What's up again? Cool. Okay, let's verify that it works again by adding every single item we could possibly have in the game. So we want more sack. We got one sack. Well, I want to show diamonds as well, but sword, teleport, let's add that. Cup, got it. Boots, got it. Gloves, extend top hat. Fire, ice, lightning, poison. Top hat, we need a, let's say we have the ice top hat, we have the firebomb, we got the couple blinks. The ghost sword, fire sword, dash charge. These aren't finished yet, but anyways. Shield, jib stash. Jib stash. Give me a jib stash. Give me a jib light. Yes, it does feel way more natural that way, for sure. Just getting the math correct. Flasks? We can have a flask. Well, a full flask. No use having an empty flask. We got maps, compasses, keys. Yep, if I were in a dungeon, I could have like key, let's say 1-4. Switches, don't need it. That should be all. Okay, that's every single item we can put on the menu at this point. Yeah, Jim's got his mustache. Oh, I forgot about Jim's mustache. It's so great to see that. Okay, there we've got, this is a lot of items, but everything is fitting nice. It's still fitting fine on this part here. Everything is moving smoothly up and down. I'm liking this a lot, actually. Yes. Let's see a screenshot of it. Well, actually, let's go to level 1. Let's see it with one more item. Loving it. This is super cool. Yeah, cool. Everything is great. And also, another added benefit of this is that it's a little bit more intuitive than the equipment. There are different kind of items than the passive items. Because before, the equipment was all packed in here at the same exact. So let's take a screenshot here. Show you what I mean. Here's old versus new. Old's on top, new's on the bottom. See here, the equipment, it wasn't really immediately and visually obvious that these equipment items are somehow different than these. But now you can, it's sort of more intuitive that these are different. These are you can equip. These are passive. And we're getting rid of the confusion too going on with this up here and that. It's just that these weren't very easy to connect visually. Now they're on the same, right next to each other. It's super clear that this is, you can remap these. We don't need to see courage on this. And the only other thing that we would need to see is the diamonds. So that's the next thing. I want to put diamonds as a passive item. Diamonds will show up like right here. You can see how many items you have or diamonds. And then boom, you have a much cleaner menu. And I also want to work on making the map bigger. I've actually did the math here, and I can actually get I think 3 more pixels per one of these squares. So that would be a significantly bigger map. And it would be a lot cooler to see a bigger map here, because You never really do. You never really see that big of a map, so you might as well use more of the space and make it easier on your eyes, especially when you're playing like on a TV and you're maybe sitting, you know, back on the couch, like away from your TV, you're playing Songbringer. It's going to be a lot easier to see a bigger map. So this is looking good. I'm going to check this in. All we did was do the math to make it jump better. We don't need these old lines of code. All right. Jumps between equipment and passive nicely. Cool. Okay, next we're going to show diamonds on here. Why doesn't it show diamonds already? Well, diamonds themselves don't have as many flags as other. Adam Diamond is just stockable. It's not a passive item. It's not an equipment. It's not craftable. So I think we need to make an exception here because the menu needs to show this, but it's not really a passive item. I guess it could be. Here, this would be a really quick way to show diamonds. I hope that doesn't break anything else. What else would break to make this? This would be fine. Passive is really only an item that's ever checked, like, in the menu. Yeah, this could work fine, I guess. That'd be a quick fix. Oh, great. We've got the diamond, but it's not showing. It's not showing the quantity yet. Or any text, but that's no problem. Let's get the quantity first. Get displayable quantity. If item equals K, item diamond. Return discount item. Easy. Yeah. Hey, Siri. What's up? It is definitely showing them, but man, it's got too big of a number to show there. We need to use a smaller font if we got big numbers. It's not best doable. I can make smaller numbers here. Where does it do this quantity? Add quantity. Anim's item quantity. Oh, yeah. Item quantity. So this will use, instead of cape font, I'll use a smaller font if the string is bigger than... Yeah, we'll just go... auto font equals ss.str.size is greater than or equal to 3. We're going to use kfont small, otherwise kfont font. Oh, I think that should be fine here. It's setting a position of pause minus L, they'll get content size dot width. Okay, so that might need to be change where it actually positions this. You've been working on a collision library? Wow, cool. In what language? What language are you working on this collision library? Hey, there we go. Yeah, it's got the small font. It's aligned wrong though. What if I only had like 99 diamonds? Would those two digits look all right? Oh, in Rust? Cool, man. How is Rust? I've heard good things about Rust. I've also heard good things about Go. Nine is still a bit big. I'm thinking two digits or more is going to become the small font. Man, this feels really good to have this menu looking better. Like it so far? Just a lack of libraries. Yeah. I hear you on that. Oh, it's centering. It's centering those. That does look better with smaller font though, and it's two digits. L like content size dot width. This is set posit. Wait, what are we using? Vec2 0. Wait, so pause, I think pause.x is it the middle or what? Dang, what item quantity. Function. Flux, here's where I'm using it. It's the current position of the sprite, which, yeah, that's exactly where the sprite is, and I think that's it's the middle of the sprite. Okay, this is the middle of the sprite plus the right edge down. Ah, so this position is the right bottom right edge. And then inside this method, I'm adding that position minus the width. Oh, yeah, that should work fine. But it'll be a lot easier if I just use vec2, a different vec for its anchor, which is the second vector. This vector should be, to make this way easier, it would just be 1.0, 0.0. And then there's no need to set the position. Simple. I love keeping things simple. Oh, but I'm modifying the horizontal alignment. That needs to be right. Did I break it? I did. I broke all the quantities. They're all gone. They're all gone. Where did they go? Oh, because I didn't even set its position. It should be pause. This I don't think needs to be any kind of H alignment. And that would all be even more simple. What's up, gaming artists? So today I'm working on making the gear menu, the equipment menu, more intuitive. better art and all that. Yeah, yeah, look, it worked. So these quantities, still the bottom right. This quantity here, oh, the bottom right for that one is just still not very bottom righty. Why is that not bottom right enough? I guess I could add a few more pixels for the small font. Okay, let's say I have more diamonds, like 511 diamonds. Max diamonds. I could get two more sacks and have even more. But 511 diamonds. Yeah, so look at that. It's still... It's like it... It's almost like it's aligning it to the left. It is a smaller font, so maybe it has something to do with that. Yeah, it could be the fact that the ones have like some space after them. Right? Let's test that theory. What if it were 510? Ah, see, 510 looks a little better. Or does it? What if it was just 500? Yeah, I don't get it. Is this right? Maybe this needs to be manually set. Hard-boiled egg just wants to go to bed. Is that the new 2 hour marks comment from Bafu? It is. It's 2 hours already. I love that comment, Boogie. If you're watching this on YouTube later or something, Boogie, I like that. Text H alignment. Right. Let's just make sure it's right, and it's using the right vector anchor. Yeah, I can't see how that would. That would be messed up, unless it's just got extra pixels at the end of the font. Yeah, that didn't work either. So I guess it needs some manual. Oh wait, there is a thing. Oh, there's a thing I can remove extra. It's letter spacing. No. Letter space something. Spacing. Change spacing. Let's make a bool is small. Or bool small font. Use small font. Use small font. If you use small font. Use small font L. I guess we didn't even need to use check for that, but anyways, letter change spacing L. Minus two, maybe? I should tighten up the text a bit, and maybe that will fix the fact that it's like not aligning right. It looks like you're standing. I am standing. I stand when coding, see? I'm a stander. I'm
setting the standard.
No, I'm not. I'm not really setting the standard. Oh, look, it did compress the font really a lot, but it didn't... surely didn't move it into the right place. Why is it so wrong? Why is it so wrong? It's like lining it all the way to the left. I don't know. Yes, I've been standing the whole time. Yep. L set position X. L get position X plus some. This is not the right way to do things, kids. But what's up? What are you supposed to do? Yeah. Your whole world has changed. The paradigm has shifted. That was wrong too. Why is the 5 all dark now? Okay, this is just wrong. We need to maybe add like 4 pixels. And that's not doing anything. So I'm almost done with today's stream. I'm just finishing up making it so you can see your diamonds again on the menu. By this is now putting your diamonds in the passive section. Rather than clunking up or cluttering up the top of this menu, it's putting everything nicely. Oh, look at that. That is the closest thing to acceptable I've seen so far. Let's see it at two, like some different digits. What if it was 311? Or 111. 111 would be crazy weird because ones are problematic. They're so skinny. There's 111. Yeah, that's the line to the right. Ah, I could deal with that. What about 99? Or 199? 199. Oh yeah, 99 looks good too. Okay, I think that might have just been the lucky thing, just add 4 pixels. Like, what if we're at like 15? That looks good too. And once again, if we're down to single digits, like 9 or 8 or 7 or whatever. 88? I'll try 88 next. 88, yeah, 88 should be the biggest number that takes up the most pixels. Yeah, 7's a nice single-digit number. 88. I think this is working well. I think this is ready to check in. Good enough for now, anyways. I mean, it's not no point trying to endlessly perfect this. I don't know why the first digit's gray. But it's not that critical just yet to fix. Yeah, the 88, it's in the corner, just like these other numbers are. I'm liking it. I'm liking it. I'm going to check this in. What's up, Tom Nook? Okay. So, I don't need this old code. Make sure this is a clean check-in. This is this now, making it so this item quantity function is nice for when you have a lot of a certain item, like a, one more check. Let's do max out the sacks. We have all 3 sacks and you can have, how many diamonds is it? I don't know, I'm just gonna put 9999 so it clamps it. That should be the maximum number we ever see. It's gonna be four digits. So let's see if four digits works. It does. But see, oh, you know what? The trick to this is that it needs to offset for the number of the size of the string. So this is this really shouldn't just be four. It should be the string size stir dot size. Wait, no, ss dot stir dot size minus one times two. 2 pixels for every gap of the number, every digit gap. Digit gap. It's the trough. It's the opposite of a knuckle. There, yeah. So the 1023 is as far to the right as it could possibly go, it looks like. If I were to make it a squeeze it by one more pixel there. I guess that looks okay. Squeezed like that. But then it changes the rest of the math, so screw it. Let's just leave it like that. And let's see, once again, a three-digit number. I've been caught up in the undertow. Oh, we need a text. We definitely need text. Before this check-in happens, we need text. Strings, English, item diamond. And we might as well add something to the change log about this too. Change log text. That's really all there is to it. Equipment menu overhaul. Diamond uses a form of currency on planet Xera. I guess that just should be diamonds. When you only have one diamond, that's going to be wrong, but excuse me. Most of the time, you're going to have more than one diamond. So I'm just going to put diamonds there. Okay, check this in. And this is going to be it for today's stream. This is what got done today. I worked on making a more nice-looking menu that is more intuitive. Before, you could still see your HUD up here. And it was kind of confusing because it was trying to show you that you could remap things by using the same color there and the same color here, but it was just not that clear. It was not very intuitive at all. So I got rid of this whole thing on top, and instead it actually puts the button right next to what you're doing right here. So it's very clear when you change a mapping that you just remapped it and that you can remap things. So Yeah, thanks, Tom Nook. It's looking better and it's also feeling a lot better. One of the next things I'm going to do to this menu is actually make the map bigger. That's going to be cool. And then also I'm going to name all the levels. They're not going to be level one. But yeah, that's it for today. And we'll see you guys next time. Have a good one, you guys. Appreciate you watching, viewing. And once again, if you do want to pre-order Songbringer, it's on sale right now on Humble Bundle. Just go to Humble Bundle, search for Songbringer. It's running a sale this weekend. I accidentally ran the sale too salely. It's like only $5 or whatever to pre-order Songbringer. I can't change it at this point. But anyways, if you want to get a really cheap copy of Songbringer, this weekend's the weekend to do it. So we'll see you guys later.